just to get a bit of feeling from the audience, who knows common Lisp from the book, having read the book, but not actually having it used in the program? Who knows common Lisp a bit better? Who knows common Lisp?
Really?
Yeah, really. Okay. So, common Lisp is a very old language. Actually, it's the second oldest. The second oldest language. Got created just after Fortran. And it manages to survive to now because we can do it's multi-paradigm language. It's like when a new thing comes out, like new fashion, like object-oriented programming, it just seamlessly goes in. It's very easy to just go from. Can have in one program, you can have an object-oriented part, another part, data-driven part, and if you want, you can have call of it too. It's very, very general language. The most common criticism is that there are too many parentheses, which is very strange, because if you know the language, you don't see any parentheses anymore, so you ask what I'm okay. This is a bit of object oriented from this. Because it's not like scheme. Scheme is a target language. Common Lisp is enterprise ready. So it has multiple namespaces. So in this case, you say that we've been very bad. We can go with the big IP namespace. So you can have a class and find IP address. You can have another package. Namespace, there's another IP address in it. And there are rules that govern how you, which names are visible where and when. The most basic of all is that it has to be predictable and repeatable. If you say a name in a context, if you say the name again, you should be the same thing. That's the basic guiding principle. So and this is like a small bit of code which will define class IP address. This says it has no ancestors. This says it has no slots or no data associated. And this just says is it has no. What are you missing? Methods. This is the nice thing about class. You have an inheritance tree of objects, but methods are not defined on objects. Methods are defined on complement lambda lists, which means how do you write them. So you can have this generic. IP address IP as inside byte, which just has one parameter IP. We decide to give it the interpretation. Then we change the method. If IP address is IPv6 address is this. If it's IPv6 address is this. And you can inherit methods. You can modify location order, so it's possible to have a method, a before method, an after method, and an around method. Then the other thing you'll see here is this is the what becomes really interesting. See, IP has overlap EB. In the final method, on A being IP address, B being IP address. Or you can define on A being a mask and B being an IP address. All the other way around. So there's no limitation on how you specialize these things. And class will automatically select the most appropriate method for you. So this results in a very a language that is optimized for change. If you are writing a program and suddenly you realize that actually you are mistaken and the method should be rewritten, you can just re-execute it, changed. Also, the method was changed. But then you have the problem, what happens to the old data that's already out? Well, you can write a method to upgrade them. And on the first time you touch the data, it automatically becomes upgraded for you. There are give an example from a recent program I wrote. I had to parse XML code. So I go through it, and then it turns out XML is lying to me. It said to me, I'm now going to describe the network, and while it was busy, it actually said, and the interface is, so it was actually describing a host to me. In a traditional language, you have to go back, knowing that it's lying to you, and reparse. In common Lisp, you just say, oh, it lied to me, into change class object host, and you just continue. So, it is a pretty useful language. So, how we use it in Debian. Basically, you do not want to work in this with any other editor than Emacs. For the VI edit, there is a project going on to have better VI integration. However, it's still so far from away from the most perfect Emacs integration. Don't look so depressed. So you start up Emacs, you just do a slide. Yeah. This will do some magic. Magic I'll describe you later. And you have slide. Yes, you need an animation. Yeah, you have to quit it when you restart it. They actually got a patch to remove it. It was such an uproar, they put it back in again. So now you are in what is called the repo, the read evo clean loop. So you can do all this traditional analysis. You can actually say, the result is actually D. So Stripe has very good implications. You go to get hash. At the end, you say, look back at the list. You can even do auto-completion, but auto-completion with a twist, because we don't have code, we cannot put an iteration like in Stripe, but we still have this stuff. It also has integrated debugger, inspector, reload. Now, the other nice thing is it has integrated commands, one command is a load system, which will load a common Lisp library. Now, in the last few years, there's been a revolution in common Lisp libraries. Because in the past, there are like a dozen different systems to describe libraries. But then some British guy wrote ASDF, which those letters here, I think, is inspiration. And it's a very simple way to describe the library. In fact, it has virtually taken over the communist market. And so much so that the three commercial vendors that are left have virtually abandoned their own system definition systems and have started using ASDF. So Debian also uses it. Now, in Debian, so we've got common Lisp implementations, like this for instance is SVCR, modern common Lisp implementations. We've got libraries. Packaging the implementations is a bit tricky. Packaging the libraries, actually, with Linnaeus DHLisp, is almost trivial. Very simple. And whenever a new thing happens that a library should take into account, this one gets modified first. So that's the kind of the easy thing. Anyway, so it says impact transistor, diff system, SIL, components in the file called SIL. That's it. The more complex one, you can also describe relationships between systems, between files, modules. You can have arbitrary commands running before, after, or during compiles. You name it. It's also fully object-oriented. Then you have the main source file itself, which is very interesting. And then change log is like new stuff, so it's not new. Control, that's basically interesting. So, we use DebConf, of course, but we also use DHLisp. The other things are pretty standard, except you have to do depends on which depends. This is important because DHLisp, fill in the necessary dependencies here. Except it's not smart enough yet to pass the ASDF file and to give dependencies on other systems. So for instance, if SIL would use split sequence, we would still have to add this sequence. No, we have to do that. So that's a bit trivial. Is libraries get installed in user share. Share because it's independent of the architecture. Come in this source class, and the name of the library. Come in this library packages, I always start with CL. That's like most of Perl Lib and most of CL. The host file itself is also trivial and actually almost nothing happens in here. Doing the usual stuff, except for dhlisp and dhinstall. What dhinstall does is go to the install directory. That just says install the ASD and the lisp file in the subdirectory. If you then run dh-lisp, it will automatically see that there is ASD file there. And that will make a symbolic link from user share common lisp systems CLisp to this ASD file. It will add also to the post install, it will call register common lisp library link. So in the pre-remove, it will also do the unregister. In the past, your library would get compiled on install. However, this generated so many problems and it made updates so unbearably long, we delayed it. So what happens if you compile a library? So you see it goes into the system file and then it goes over the files. Where are they? They are in cache, common disk, your user ID, implementation name. So this is just we now use user ID because in past we use user name, but then if you do as you do when you do something, then your name is still you, but your effective user ID will be root, so 0. So you will be writing files in your personal cache directory, which are for good, which is not good. So now we use the effective user ID. Implementation name. Because different implementations use different compiled files, they have to be separated. And of course the library file is not interlibrary caches. If you upgrade the library, post install, it will delete all cached copies of the compiled files. So that it will be certain that the system will have to recompile it. If you install a new implementation, it will remove all compiled files for that implementation. This in general should not be done. But in practice, people like SVCR, they're focused on developing code. And if they modify something that breaks backwards compatibility, which is essentially a memory dump, they won't really care. So to avoid problems, you just need them all. is from Tars. So, common Lisp controller, because that's the package. And common Lisp required. Why not required? Because required is a defined function in LC Lisp. So if you would use package common Lisp controller, there would be a clash. So to give people the choice to import
but to use that function, do you have to do anything special?
No.
So common support is a little about that being.
It's loads of complexity in both the positive limitations.
I didn't understand why you said you can't use standard require.
Standard require.
You said for this or something? I didn't quite catch what it does.
You can't use standard require because standard require is a defined LC function and you are not allowed to modify any symbol that is defined in the LC standard. So although it is possible in most implementations to modify require itself, after a while bad things start to happen.
Bad things start to happen quietly?
Bad things start, no. In general, bad things do not happen quietly. It can be vocal. Especially SBCL. SBCL has the policy that the standard has to be read literally. So, for instance, the standard says that def constant can be used to define constants. However, if you do def constant for, you say it's 3, it's perfectly happy. But if you say def constant, then bar is a list for 3. If you compile this, it will complete. Why? Because the list will always be a different one. So it's not the same. It's a definition for what the same means as a copy of this. It actually means the same. So how to make a common list enabled implementation is a bit specialized. People really want to package all the missing implementations. Come and see me. Questions? More questions?
Is that really all there is to it? I thought it was more complicated than that.
I'm a lazy person, so
I remember 2 years ago, I had to do a whole bunch of things where it was ASDF colon and various commands to try and compile XML programs.
Yes, of course, the ASDF itself, you have to use it's ASDF operate on system, and you have to use ASDF root on. So that this is a portable way using only 8 ASDF to compile nodes like in Debian, you can just use require. Or if you're using Slime, it's just comma node system.
So it's not require.
Well, in Slime you just do comma system.
Now, these commands, they're all saved so that you can have the source file? Or
the, the commands in the repo, yes, they're saved, but...
Okay, like before, if you contain a bunch of commands.
Yes.
And they will alter the state of this the stack and dictionary. And then they just save a binary dump of it, and you get this application, but you might have some source, but you're not seeing the previous source that's built on.
It has a save list from die, which is actually got improved. Since this is historically, common Lisp implementations always had two types. Like forth, that you have the world. If you want to make a new version, you just modify the world and you save this to die. It's draw your attention to new option executable, which will make a 25 megabyte executable hello world. Other implementations, like for instance ECL, are Lego colleges, had the idea that it was wasteful. And today, if this is ECL, you see, I want to have an application, I want to have these and these and these source files loaded with these and these and these libraries. And then I shall create a new world loading only these things. However, any changes you did in your current world are lost. So it's a bit too philosophies.
So are we able to do
both of them? It depends on your implementation. For instance, CVCL and the Yofspring, CSVCL, they both have the save list and die. So you have the world.
So they save that binary or they help develop the source so you can re-compile it at a future date or modify it?
No, the world consists only of the compiled code. In theory, it's possible to have the source code in there and to practice the source code.
I guess I'm going to confuse the distinction of where the source code ends and the compiled code begins.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that was a problem in the 70s. After that, what you described in PAL was called MacLisp. However, it got dead, and the only surviving view of the world is common Lisp, in which there are source files that get compiled and loaded into.
Okay, for instance, I'm getting the impression from this slime here that you type in a command and it's compiled on the spot. It goes into this world where compiled code, and at the end you save us a die and the binary log.
Yes.
So how do you go backwards to see what you type so you can modify and recompile?
Well, you should not do coding on in the repo. You should open the best source file. There are very handy commands like execute as expected. So you go on there and you just say dot.
Okay, so as long as it's that one, we all
yes. You can have a little comment in the index. Take around because it uses 5 a.m., which is a regression test. And it's, I just installed it. You can see it's compiling now. Lastly, you have to get all style warnings, which are mostly fine. class, you do it, and you have to control arms X, and it's done. And of course, suppose that you have this. Predates sort of misconceptions. So you have arbitrary length of bytes, and in fact the predecessor to Common Lisp, the default output radix, so encoding, was octal on its phone. Now actually we use decimal. Well, actually, Common Lisp actually has a format macro to format a number as a Roman numeral, and there is actually the option to use the new Roman numeral method or the old Roman numeral method. It can print out numbers written out in English. It's baroque, it's always mixed.
Well, I mean, I'm actually interested in how to do the thing in this. Looks like you're doing some of that right here.
Yes, actually there is this nice, there are a few nice libraries. There is an MD5 library that has the same speed as C, and there is a regular expression library which is faster than Perl, which is pretty cute. There actually was a bet in the bar. End of the author said that this was not fast, and he would buy him a beer if he could type the regular expression by a beer was faster than Perl. So he wrote it. It's very nice. Actually, a few years ago, the problem with this was that there were not a lot of libraries available. Now the problem is that there are too many libraries available.
All of which you have to maintain yourself.
No. There are actually a few very well maintained and developed libraries. We've got not one but two different, let's say, Lisp on Rails like things. We have KPAX and we've got Uncommon Web, which actually Nukadev is maintaining. Which actually are pretty cool stuff to do because it's just like the dialog, ask user this, if that, then that, and if this, and then do nice web pages.
So, I have a question. So we're talking more actually about library. And for example, for a UCD or for other kind of program like Snappy, WM, which is a window manager using Common Lisp, we need a simple executable to let the user start.
Yes.
So I know that common is not for very, very nearby end user because it's quite complex. But anyway, you can think about, so can you think about a simple way to start finding this control? Which is not CL large, actually. It's different.
Yes, the whole, it is an issue that in the past, because we've got a slide like this, the concept of actually producing an executable to give to somebody has never actually been a priority. And even the new executable option of saving spend time will just produce a very big new copy of SBCL. It would be much, much better if there would be if different Lisp programs could use the same base SBCL image. And up to recently this was possible because they had a static space. But now they improved everything and now everything is dynamic again. So it's possible to share data between implementations, but of course, communism has got connection. Not describing the language actually, just implying that you can allocate the system will not die on you. For instance, it says that 70 megabytes of dynamic space, which is multi-generational chain of connectors. So, if you have two different disk libraries at startup applications, they would use the same virtual image, let's say. However, the first time they do a garbage collection, they will reshuffle all of this, and they don't share anymore. And though I like Lisp a lot, a 128 megabytes window manager, well actually how big is KDE nowadays? It's a bit big, but the solution should be found. My best bet at the moment is ECR actually. It compiles Lisp codes to C codes, then loads the object. That would possibly produce real executables.
But then the problem is that most of the time it is swamped from this line, you can interact with the primary problem that you are using.
Yes.
And you do the same with the ECI combined by EC.
Now you can interact, yes. But it's not that you will be a slime there.
Useful to emulate the approach of the symbolic chains. The way they have these layers, they have a real chain and you always tie into various points.
Yes, but
is that possible today?
Yes, it's very possible today. Actually, there is a project going that will boot your machine in, let's say, SBCR plus a few low-level drivers. It's the whole way. However, it's you all share the same memory. So there's no isolation between users. So in the 60s this was a great idea.
It was about chain and some protection, but it was more of a process. Was there a function of that?
No, the symbolics had on the processor itself would not execute illegal commands. So if you if you could put data in an array, the processor itself would check if the array was big enough and if your data was compatible with the array data. However, it is perfectly possible to set F, and then there is this one variable that contains the hash table, which contains all the virtual memory information. It's very possible to set that to nil. Something everybody does at one time, and the machine is broken, you have to reuse. So.
Okay, so they say it never infection.
No. And even, I mean, the whole concept of protection is against this philosophy. You have not really seen, but if you define slots in objects, you can define readers to read, function to read that slot on the object. You can define an accessor, which is something you can read and write with. But if there's no accessor defined, you can just use slot value of the name of the object, name of the slot, and you just set the value.
And the compiler has no way of helping you see that you did not do that.
No, no, no. It's implied that if you do that, you know what you're doing.
But I thought that scope gives you sort of protection.
The scope is protection, but you just use name of package colon, and protection is bound. Protection is only there if it's accidental.
Yeah.
Yes. That if you have a reader function, it uses the setf as an accessor function. The compiler will complain saying, hey, it's a reader function, not an accessor function. That's there.
But certainly if I choose to circumvent that.
If you choose to circumvent it, go right ahead. It's a choice, not enforcement. Also, for instance, type handling. Some people think that common Lisp has no types. This is untrue. Everything has a type. If you have an object, it always has implied a type. You need to type something else. So, type 7. We'll say it's an integer. Yes? And in the source code, you can say that I declare this to be an integer between 7 and 5. So 7 and 15. And as DCL will actually check this for you. And if you give that function 4, it will throw you an error saying 4 is not between 7 and 15. And it will actually do also the type propagation. So if you declare a value though, to be between 7 and 14, and then in your function you multiply it by 2, it knows that the result is between 14 and 28. So it has pretty strong type handling. If you choose it to be. If you do not want it, and you don't declare anything, everything will run just as nice. Yes, the problem is that it is extremely defined what kind of result it gives. For instance, if you want to have an HTTP connection, you say this. I'm talking strings here, I'm sending strings. However, if then you want to send your data over and you want to go to binary mode, that's not possible with the standard problem is streams. Gray streams allowed you to do this.
Okay, well the standard streams, I guess, but I didn't understand like what my standard from I always see you read your standard correct standard, it's bytes.
It's not bytes. It's a bag of what you define it to be. That makes a bit of a problem. Actually gray streams now just in place for most of my simple streams, which are not simple, which are streams that allow them to be changed in the middle of an operation to another encoding. But this opens a whole can of worms, because for instance you have the function found position, which does not tell you how many bytes you've read, but tells you how many units that you've read. So Unicode becomes really interesting, and then if you change your coding in the middle, it becomes really, really interesting. So it's very difficult to do the right thing.
So if I just stick to the POSIX rewrite functions, and the POSIX compatible, you know,
No. They are actually pretty good. It's just that sometimes they have odd corner cases. Like, there was this one guy complaining recently that it's almost impossible to use gzip on a stream, which is true. You cannot make a stream. In normal streams, you cannot make a stream and say, if I write that stream with that code, that function will transform the data for you. But in simple streams you can. So, but that simple stream is not part of the standard.
So standard streams become part of common system?
Yes. The same with path names. That's utterly political. Path names actually are made up of symbolic path names. The symbolic path names have a host argument. If you said my host is my VMS machine over there, the rest of the syntax would change to VMS syntax. But when they made standard, the other people were afraid that symbolics was pushing too much their mark and standard. So they voted against some parts of the path name standard. So the path name standard is like halfway to symbolics, but not far enough. So in some cases it shows, for instance, it is impossible to give a correct default host, because it don't define what the default host should look like and how you make it. The only thing you can do is to take the path name you know and ask, what's your host? And then to reuse that. But that's a trap many people fall into. It's historical baggage, but luckily it's the only historical baggage we have.
Nog 12 minuten. Standards defined on implementations, I think, are the very bad thing. I once talked to a guy who wrote about to become a Lisp compiler. And he had asked in that involved a few poignant questions. At the end of the exchange, Lenny Wall said, "I'm very happy now there are three people in the universe that know how the parsers work." So this does not fill me with confidence. That's also why I've been doing it for kernel 6. Because it's, well, since then, I think it's time to be late. It's a communist piece of incredibly, it's a book like this thing, established, that defines almost everything, which is very nice because there's always a problem like this, they've got endless battles describing, yes, but in paragraph 16 subjects and C you say this, and at the end of the standard, there is a list of words and what we mean with them. It's very long. It has things like equals, the same, and must. So, we are finished giving this one the unreadable for us. We've got two projects, let's say, on a code like Lisp. CommonLisp.net, a sort of mailing list, CLW, and to add the diversity on the Alioth, we've got a CLW project in which you find links to the mailing list, but also to the DAGs repositories you maintain that contain almost all our packages. Lucas packages. So, Dark has actually become the sort of the standard expression existed in this world.
Even though Dark is associated with Haskell.
Haskell is a very nice language.
Indeed. It's a weird version of Lisp.
It's a nice language. It's not coming this, but it's close enough. So this is the main one. So come on over. Also, it's a new question. He won't bite too much.
On the contrary.
I'm always happy with the people that want to make data or send patches even if it's
not
too many packages or anything.
I have a question for you from over there.
Yeah.
What is your fault in this stuff?
Actually, I'm using it.
Okay, so you're not the packager?
I'm the packager now.
Okay. I'm the packager of RepPoison, so.
Because actually, the oldest packager, NASA packager, doesn't use it anymore. So I think that I already version prepared on my machine, which have a new version, which is a CDS setup, and so we should have it works now.
Peter, how would you feel if you gave a demo of a window manager written in Common Lisp?
But actually, I have two window managers. One is standWM, which is a background on that. And then another one, which is called Eclipse.
Which that was the original Common Lisp one.
And which is more or less similar to open box or so you don't have to be explained.
I remember 4 years ago telling Sean, you gotta rewrite this in Common Lisp. And at that time I could not even compile Eclipse. It just the system was not there yet. But I'm glad to hear that it is. Yeah.
Actually he's also doing very interesting work on the Common Lisp, which is a really nice toolkit from Ruby on Rails. And I was trying to force work into forcing you to do a project with Common Lisp. A bit more forcing it to allow me.
5 minutes left on tape.
I think I'll be filming it yesterday with before the mantra, the talk about doing kind of video tricks. We had a laptop with the stream on it. And then I had the video camera videoing the stream on the laptop. So we had the laptop, and then it had the laptop. There was a 5 seconds delay. We were doing funny things, and
okay, I've got one last one. I wanted to write a commonless application, but I wanted to also have a configuration file which was just commonless statements. And I wanted to be able to just suck that in when I get a signal and evaluate it. I haven't modified some code variables, and I realize this isn't working because the bicycle is open, or because of how the eval statement works. Is there a way to do this, or is there a better way to do a config file? That doesn't probably. I really want to know services of code in a runtime.
In a config?
Well, just a file with arbitrary coding and have it evaluated at the top level or an arbitrary level and just become part of the application. I'm built upon by the application and it's running.
Why is it working? I suppose talk shouldn't stop you.
Well, you know, it'll do its thing, but I couldn't get it to modify Google variables, and I was told that was something to do with who else is speaking.
No, if they're defined to be special, so it starts around it. However, if you do modify normal variables at top level, that's undefined. And you're not supposed to do that.
Okay. Alright, so just, I didn't realize the server's being special.
No, you have to do defrag, or declare, or special, and then they're special.
Okay, and then the servers are important to mention.
Yes. But SBCM will warn you if you've got special variables not with stars, because people are so used to seeing stars, you don't see a star. It's a deadly trap, because if you declare a variable special, that name becomes special, not that variable. So if you declare special E, all E's become special. So if you use that in an iteration, interesting things might happen.
Google functions, for instance, might want to redefine a function that I'm using for certain things.
Functions are but you have to do a file to start a clean package also. It is undefined what package you are.
So I have to do a package.
Yes. I'm this close to sending a patch to SBCL to make the lack of a package at top level. Fatal compiler, because people don't do it, and then you get very strange effects. Because if you start just doing stuff, your variables will therefore be in random packages. And for instance, ASDF protects you from doing that by creating a new temporary package, loading your file, and then afterwards deleting the package. So if you've forgotten to do in package, your objects will be in a package that no longer exists, which is real file. It's
so if you read this, there's a question about the configurations. And if I was to redefine a function of the bicycle scope be global or
Death thing is always global.
Okay.
You cannot have a death thing in the death thing. No, you can, but it's probably global. So, it's no use. We've been thinking Deutsch as
Steam. Yeah, well, I read a lot about Steam and I've been in my life.
Yeah.
And I'm Steam.
Well, even Steam is a little bit.
You're asking me very helpful.
Tape is finished. We are recording to disk 2, so if you want to continue, you can. but we don't have
Can you make a tape of the audience? Because I thought that too many dogs would be there.
I have zoomed out. I have zoomed out, so you can see it on the tape how much people there were.
That's great. You have been doing this meeting. In the past, it was in the living room of one guy, well, five guys down the block to go. And I went 2 weeks ago, it was 170 something guys in the hotel. Getting a bit. Okay.
Well, speaking of that, about the modularity, why is not that common to develop a common list compared with, for example, C or Pascal or Python?
Why is not so common?
Yeah.
That's a good question. They've been doing a lot of thinking about it, and the most cocky answer is that only good programmers want to use common list programs. If you see common list programs, there are none that only know common list. I mean, there are billions of C programs that only know C, but there are no common list programs that only know common list. Most of them also know at least C, Pascal, Haskell, Colab. At the common list conferences, you go to Colab code without even mentioning that now they're doing Colab. It's assumed you know it. It's a cool language, not? The same with Erlang. Say that fluently to Erlang without mentioning it, actually. They still want to use common list, so it must be something that experienced people want. So
maybe it would help if there was a simple cheat sheet or how to do common C tasks in Lisp, for instance. How do you do a hello world? How do you open a socket? And then just use a bit.
Listen, the first example, hello world, is at the one time useless, at the other time too complex. Because doing hello world is like double quote hello world, double quote enter. Yeah, big deal. Making a hello world application,
right.
Who?
See, no, that's the problem. See, it's very simple. One line is okay, type this command line, and you've now got an application that you can run. So
that's a culture clash. So,
but that makes a simple mapping between those sorts of things. So as a C programmer, you're used to, okay, well, I can do this. I know how to. If you could do that mapping and say, well, come this, you do this, it works out the same. And a lot of that is cultural, and you just word of mouth and this right now. Or you have to know how to search all the resources available. There's so much material that can be hard to find stuff. Which is why I'm here today, because I do know it's mostly all tradition right now.
That is actually a very nice book that you found.
Could you tell us about that? I noticed that there.
It's, the author is a Java expert, actually. And he's covered his work. He decided to like it. He liked it, and he wrote a little book about it. And, but it's not like a guide for like one to one. No, it more describes about how it works. And then there's generally builds up the complexity of the final until the end it does an MP3 browser. I think it's moving because also it checks the tags and stuff. But I think realistically, this is the closest you can get. Because there is no direct from the one another.
was thinking something like doing that by turning in type of programming in the Unix environment. Something like that for Lisp would be useful. So it introduces you to the various tools and says, here's how to do most common tasks.
Yes.
Do
we have common tasks? But I think the most common patterns he also discusses is with whatever. It's very often used.
It's a beautiful idea.
Yeah, and also the whole concept of having locations and then you update set F is pretty powerful. Not talking about macros then, because that would blow some C programs under the water. On the other hand, comparing with language Ruby, in Ruby they are now complaining. There are too many newbies in Ruby. The level of expertise is going down, which is normal. If programming becomes popular, all newbies for it. I mean,
Even the experts start as newbies.
Yes, but there are newbies that learn and there are newbies that do not. A few years ago there was this student guy on common like this, Eric Magel. He was... Well, aggressive isn't the word. Very aggressive. Very, very aggressive. I mean, extremely aggressive. I mean, you are so stupid you don't even deserve to live is aggressive.
Yeah.
But he was always right. But it would never insult a newbie immediately. It would always give them a subtle hint that they might be wrong. Some newbies got the subtle hint and survived the encounter. But then you had great flame wars because they didn't. I would just like to say one final thing. It's, it would be interesting for you guys when you study the past, because I looked at this conference and the whole semantic web thing. If you look at it like with your eyes slightly closed and twisted, it's the 1960s all over again. John is dark, John owned by Mary. That's all prologue all over again. But now, bigger, heavier, with XML and URLs, so it's incredibly big and slow to parse. Just convert it to prologue and suddenly it becomes easy and simple and fast because we've been doing it for 30 years. So, that's one of the cool things that we're doing now. They showed that they had this contract for the phone company. They had a database of callers, who called who, and they wanted to find loops. So A calls B calls C calls D calls E calls A again. Because that are friends. And those friends would get an invitation from the special friends plan for their mobiles. And they wanted to do it. They wanted to do it, but seven inner joints on SPR table was a bit too much. So they went to semantic web, they went in the whole of my database, and milliseconds to get it out. Because so known stuff has been optimizing it for years now. Also, if you want to remain XML space, then I wish you luck.
Thank you, Peter. I feel I've learned more here than I would have in a month on IRC.
And I don't buy this piece of you. That's also the IRC channel, also is very live nowadays.
Other good channels, just the communications are.
Yes, but it's actually better than email sometimes. Sometimes it's worse because people do not think so much about what they read. On the other side, it's much faster. But then, like the end here, it's a bit addictive. But, hello, where you are? I'm in Hack Lab 2. I'm sitting next to you. Ah, yes, I haven't seen you. That's a bit.